he's going to have a big game. They're going to throw the ball down low to the post to their big guys and see if they can get it done.
Scott Thornley is our referee, about to toss the ball up. He does, and it goes to the Baylor Bears. The two umpires working with Thornley tonight, Michael Eggers and Terry Moore.
Well, at the beginning of the game for Baylor, look for them to try to establish the post. They'll throw the ball down low to Lomas. Good deflection by Kansas.
So they try to take it right inside. And as Hubert said, the ball is knocked away. So turnover, Baylor Bears to open the ball game.
Well, this is going to be the key offensively for Kansas. Can they get quality shots versus this zone of Baylor?
Inside. And that is, of course, Marcus Morris. The Morris twins playing a very large part in the good things that have happened here at KU this year. Marcus got grounded a week ago tonight. Did not start the game in Nebraska, and then turned out to be the MVP of the ball game. Tweety Carter left all alone, and he'll get the first two for the Bears. Boy, it looks like Collins took a blow on his left hip.
Looks like they were playing defense and ran right into Josh Lomers. Hit his, both of those guys, bang knees, and looks like Sherron Collins is going to be okay and staying in the game.
Well, Bill stood up and said, Bill Self stood up and said, you know, you want me to take a 30-second timeout? And he said, nope, I'm fine. So the veteran senior guard is going to stay on the floor. Xavier Henry back across to Collins. Morris not there, skying for the rebound, and we'll say this a lot tonight. The Baylor Bears, that's Anthony Jones who brought that one down. Efe Udoh, number 13, much talked about and for very good reason on the boards and also scoring for these Baylor Bears. Carter on the run, unlucky on the shot. Lomers battles, and Morris takes it away from him. Take a look at the starters in tonight's ball game. Carter, Laisdarius Dunn, Anthony Jones, Efe Udoh, and Josh Lomers. And for Kansas, maybe not a surprise. He started all but one game last year, but Brady Morningstar comes back into the lineup, handling the ball right now. And of course, Xavier Henry, the outstanding freshman on the floor, number one, played at Putnam City High School in Oklahoma City. Collins. Nice dish to Aldridge.
That's exactly what you want to do against this zone. You want to get the ball into the middle through pass or penetration. Sherron Collins penetrates, finds Cole Aldridge underneath the basket for the dunk.
Collins has got a tough assignment tonight. He's got Tweety Carter, who is very active and a very good shooter. As that three-pointer is off the mark, and Morris tips it back out to Aldridge. KU will run. Henry for three. Nope, not there. And he stepped out of bounds before the shot.
Well, this is something they worked on practice for about 45 minutes yesterday, attacking this 1-1-3 zone. You see Sherron Collins, good penetration, getting into the lane and finding Cole Aldridge. He's one of the guys they want to get going, established down low in the paint. They need their big guy, Cole Aldridge, to dominate down low in the lane.
Turn around and Udoh with his first 2 points of the night. Transfer from Michigan. And folks, I'll tell you, we'll get Hubert to talk more about it, because he saw him when he was playing for Michigan, and he said it is a total metamorphosis on him. He's really changed.
Well, that's the number one difference between this Baylor team. Their balance on the offensive end. Good pass. We talked about Kansas when they played Baylor in the Big 12 tournament, that they settled for a lot of jump shots, particularly Sherron Collins. Here early in the game, he hasn't shot that outside jump shot. He's put the ball on the floor and gotten some easy baskets underneath.
You know, in fact, I did that game last year in the Big 12 tournament, and the 2-3 zone really gave Kansas trouble. That ball knocked out of bounds, touched last by Lomer. But the point was, the shooting by Collins, he only hit 6 out of 20, Hubert, but he never got to the free throw line. So it took away some of his aggressiveness.
I agree with you. And the whole team, they only went to the free throw line 10 times, but I think it took everybody off guard from the Big 12. They just started playing the zone in the Big 12 tournament. They were a man-to-man team for the whole year. They lost 10 of their last 12 conference games, and Coach Drew said, we need a change. Let's play a zone.
Well, alley-oop. It came down to Henry. So the second foul on Josh Wolmers. We'll talk more about it after the break. KU 6-4. Long time, 31 points, and they have got a good thing going, and particularly with what Udo brings to the table.
Well, they lost a lot of talent from last year's team. They lost four guys out of their rotation, and they didn't know that Epe Udo, they knew that he would do it defensively. But his emergence on the offensive end has been huge, and Brady Morningstar knocking down the three.
So Morningstar gets the start. He started 34 of 35 games last year. The only game that he did not start was Senior Day. Dunn for three, way outside, and he gets it.
3-point basket, a big time shooter, one of the best shooters, not only in the Big 12, but in the country. Pin down plays, you have to get him in transition. He's averaging 25 points a game in his last three, so he's on fire from the perimeter.
By the way, for Baylor, that's 568 consecutive games that they have had a three. Xavier Henry put the ball in his left hand to put it back up to ward off the defender. Scott Drew, seventh season as the head coach at Baylor, 1-6 against Kansas, but that big one was last year in the Big 12 tournament. Udo, first foul on him. I'll tell you what he has done after the probation that he took over from. As you look at Udo, it truly has been a miraculous thing.
Well, he's rebuilt this program. I mean, there was 2005, 2006. This was a team that couldn't even play non-conference games. So now, back-to-back postseason appearances, 2008 NCAA tournament, and then last year got to the finals of the NIT. He has this program continuing to grow.
He replaces Cole Aldrich.
So Cole Aldrich will get a breather. And Markeith Morris. So both Morris twins on the floor right now. Here's Tweety Carter. They get it across the time zone easily.
And this has been a change for Kansas over the last couple weeks, kind of picking up some time, full pressure, full court, trying to create a couple turnovers, get them going defensively.
Acey into the lineup for the Baylor Bears. Quincy Acey, the ball taken away. Here's Collins. He's moving pretty well after that screen that he took, which really stung his hip. Dunn pulls up 15 feet, wouldn't go. You gotta like the poise of Udo. Set out a year, he is a junior, but acting as a real leader on the floor. He's gonna take a three.
See, he couldn't make that shot 2 years ago. He wouldn't even shoot a three. And now on the offensive end, he can post up, use both hands, and now he can step out on the perimeter, put the ball on the floor, and occasionally he can knock down the three. He is a complete package on the offensive end.
Henry. That's Marcus Morris.
Well, we talked about there's been a lot of heat on the big guys since that Tennessee game where all three big guys, Markeith, Marcus Morris, and also Cole Aldrich, were all in single-digit points against an undersized Tennessee team. They really wanted to establish him, and Marcus Morris has been huge the last two games down low in the post.
Quincy Acey just threw the ball directly to the KU defender. That's four turnovers against the Baylor Bears. Collins got Carter in the air, too hard off the back iron, and Tweety Carter has it taken away, and he was fouled by Morningstar.
Well, off defensively for Baylor, they run a ton of pick and rolls and say Epe Udo gets Ron Collins and for him to roll. He has the ability to roll towards the basket or pop in that situation and knock down the three.
Well, Tyrell Reed comes in the ball game replacing Morningstar. A lot of boos on that call, and whether it was or whether it wasn't. Anyway, Morningstar will get a breather, but he came out and helped out his ball club. As a week ago tonight, he didn't have a bunch of stuff that really showed up in the box score, but he did a lot of little things, which Coach Self was complimentary of after the ball game. Well, so he gets a start tonight.
Well, he's a chemistry guy. He's a guy that can really defend, and on the offensive end, he's a player that's willing to make the extra pass. So he does an excellent job of feeding the post, and already here in the game, he's an excellent jump shooter. He's already knocked down 1 3-pointer.
Well, we mentioned last week, Brady's dad played here at KU 74 and 75, and his sister played 4 years of volleyball at KU. Very athletic family. I think they're going to call him over the back on that one against the big fella, Udo. That's the second foul on him. And a real tough grimace on his face after picking that one up.
And that's huge for Baylor because this is a team that only plays eight guys. So they don't have a lot of depth to bring in Quincy Acey. So now Josh Lomas, a guy that really doesn't play big minutes, is going to have to play extended minutes down low on the post.
You know, it's interesting with Carter working against Collins. These guys are really good friends. They both were McDonald's All-Americans. At the same year as a travel is called and a turnover against KU. Thomas Robinson had just come into the lineup, gets the walk called on him.
Yeah,
but back to Collins and Carter, they played on opposing McDonald's All-American teams, but were there at the same time. Established a friendship. We saw a big hug after the meeting with the officials before the ball game.
Well, they're similar guards. They're small guards, big bodies, but they're extremely quick to get into the lane, finish, shoot from three. And when you talk about Tweety Carter, this was a scoring point guard coming out of high school. He's done an excellent job, but now understanding when to be a facilitator leads the Big 12 in assists.
He comes out early to shoot every day on game day, and I happen to have come into the arena here early today, and I asked him about his defense, and he said, I really take pride in that. As Jones loses the ball, and here comes Collins. And I'll tell you what he said. As soon as Collins finishes the spin move and has it blocked by Lomas, and they turn it right back over. Xavier Henry, nope, would not go. Rebounded by Bader. Anyway, just to finish the thought, he said, I really take pride in my defense. I said, who's the toughest guy in the conference to guard? As Carter misses on the three, he said, no doubt about it, my good friend Sharon Collins.
Good pass.
Nice pass, and Markeith can't get it to go down. And as they fight for it, it is KU basketball. Take a timeout. Kansas 13-10. Right now the fouls are mounting on Baylor.
So it's been the offensive effort and execution of Kansas that has put Baylor with their big guys on the bench.
Well, into the lineup is Elijah Johnson, number 15 for KU. Henry, by the way, Xavier Henry already has 5 steals in his ballgame.
He's an outstanding defensive player. People talk about him that he's a big-time scorer. Yes, he is. But what really has impressed me is this is a guy that can really defend as well. He's done a nice job in the first half. And he's a guy that can get it going on the perimeter. He's on fire.
Lace Darius Dunn. And, folks, he's a junior. His lifetime scoring average against Kansas, and you got to consider the competition, is 20 points a ball game.
Darius Dunn, he's a guy that loves to come off of pin down plays, and you can see him doing an excellent job moving without the basketball in this situation. You see Cole Aldrich, he has to stunt in that situation, meaning he has to step out maybe 1 or 2 seconds, take that jump shot away and go back to his man. If you give him a clean look on the perimeter, Darius Dunn's gonna knock it down.
Well, just off the mark with the long jumper, Tyrell Reed, who came into the lineup joining Brady Morningstar in this grouping. Well, the ball knocked away, Morningstar, and it went off Lace Darius Dunn last. But that was a nice defensive play by Morningstar. Good quick hands. Jefferson into the lineup, number 34.
And you can see Kansas offensively, because of the two big guys for Baylor, Epe Udo and Josh Lomers, out of the game. Throwing the ball down low on the post, trying to establish Cole Lawler's down low on the paint.
Jefferson, we mentioned him. He's a freshman out of Killeen, Texas. Inside pass, and that is too easy for Aldridge if you allow him to have that kind of space to get a pass right underneath.
Well, during practice yesterday, they kept getting on Cole Aldridge to get better position in the lane. They feel like that he's been giving up his position, catching the ball maybe one or two steps outside the lane. That time, he was able to hold it underneath the basket, and they feel his percentages will go up if he catches the ball closer to the rim.
We have mentioned it before, but Cole lost his grandmother. He had a very long battle with cancer, and he and his grandmother were very, very close. And she just passed away this past weekend. That's a look at his father who was here. You can see number 45, Dad, on his baseball cap. Second on the way and in and out. Unlucky on that shot. Anyway, hopefully, you know, the burden is lessening for him, because it's really been weighing heavy on him with the long illness of his grandmother. 14-13, Kansas by one over Baylor. Done. The runner and the jam, and that's going to be basket interference. And Hubert, I'm not sure he needed to help it.
He didn't need to help it. Yeah. Lace Darius Dunn did an outstanding job breaking the trap out of the pick and roll, was able to split it, get the ball into the middle. Beautiful floater of Cole Aldridge, and that was going in. And Quincy Acey taking a basket away from his teammate.
And he looked over at the head coach and then looked at Dunn and said, I'm sorry,
big fella. You owe me one.
That's right. There's one that won't go on a sheet that should have. Collins got that mouth guard outside of his mouth. I wonder why. Trying to catch his breath. Cole Aldridge on the turnaround. Not there. And that's Dunn who comes away with the rebound. Here's Carter. Length of the court pass, and just a little too far for Jefferson. Ron Franklin, Hubert Davis, coming to you with our very talented ESPN crew from a jam-packed Fog Allen Fieldhouse. It is Wednesday night in the Big 12 Conference on ESPN2.
On the last possession, they were able to get the ball down low to Cole Aldridge in the lane, and he didn't use his left hand. He's going to have to finish those plays, doing an excellent job getting the position. He's got to get to the free throw line or score.
That's a nice job by Baylor of getting backside help. And the ball knocked almost out of bounds, touched last by Lace Darius Dunn. So it's KU basketball. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Aldridge. Morningstar, a little too hard on the pass, taken away by Dunn. Lace Darius Dunn, long three, and he cans it again.
Ron, you have to pick him up as soon as he crosses half court. And this is a guy that can shoot the ball from anywhere. Good penetration and five for Xavier Henry on the three.
Henry with his first three of the night, and I was about to say first lead by Baylor. Well, it was, but it was a short live thing. 8.5 minutes to play first half. Not a surprise. This is a very tight matchup between two good ball clubs, although KU is a heavy favorite in this ball game. Morningstar with good quick hands. Markeith Morris. Take a timeout. Sometimes a play like that can ignite your team. It certainly has the crowd. think what happened on the play, the Baylor coaches wanted to charge on the play, but the defender started as he got closer to give ground on him, so he wasn't set.
I thought it was a great no call. You know, it's that 18 by 24 imaginary rectangle underneath the basket. So yeah, if he was in there, that was a block. Great call by the referees.
Marcus, by the way, with 8 points now.
He's played so well for Kansas down low in the last three games, been consistent in terms of scoring down low on the plate and defensively and rebounding.
Well, they trap. AC almost throws it away. Anthony Jones holds on to it. Anthony, a sophomore out of Houston, played at Yates High School. Very highly sought after player. Here's Carter. Dishes it right there, close proximity, and they get it to go down. AC.
And see, that's the development of Tweety Carter. A couple years ago, he would have shot that. But his ability to break that trap, get the ball in the middle, find AC where he can score.
Collins looked as though he was going to have a good assist. And now Marcus Morris is going to be called for that foul, as he took the legs out from under the Baylor player. Final in the Big 12 Conference is Texas Tech. Finally got off the snide. They were 0-3 in conference play. They just defeated Iowa State. 19-18 our score, with 7:24 remaining first half.
And Baylor has to feel great about what position they are here in the first half. You see freshman Nolan Dennis lose the basketball.
Well, Nolan got a little ahead of himself there and couldn't slow it down enough. I was afraid he was just going to dribble out of bounds.
A little bit excited as a freshman. First time at Allen Fieldhouse.
Well, that's 11 turnovers against Baylor. Well, we got a couple of great basketball matchups to start Saturday afternoon. Action begins at noon. Number 4, Villanova takes on resurgent St. John's at the Garden. And at 2 o'clock, number 3, KU will battle some Hilton Magic at Iowa State. Fran Frischella and I'll be there for that one. Men's college basketball presented by 5-Hour Energy on ESPN Saturday.
Well, Villanova hasn't missed a beat. Scotty Reynolds has been fantastic. Seniors, let's stop talking about freshmen. Let's talk about seniors. Scotty Reynolds has been fantastic at the guard position, scoring, getting to the free throw line, defending, and Villanova still undefeated in Big East play.
That is a veteran Villanova team, isn't it?
It is. They have youth in the front court. Those big guys like Luke Taliaferro, Maurice Sutton come through, Antonio Pena, they can get back to a Final Four.
Tweety Carter misses, but they come away with a rebound. That's AC. Carter trying to line up
Good
give and go. AC will go to the line. Boy, he came down really hard on that hip.
Well, defensively for Kansas, one of the things they need to know is when Quincy Atesy sets the pick and roll, he is rolling hard. A lot of times he likes to slip, but he is not a pick and pop guy. So the rotation, weak side defenders, got to come over just a little bit quicker on AC and meet him outside the lane. But been really good offensively here in the first half, a guy that can finish around the basket.
That foul was on Cole Aldrich. It's his first. Sheckerman got them both.
Wow, if you ask Coach Drew, you can be up by one, your two best post players on the bench here on the road, he would take it with 6 minutes to go.
Let me tell you something. AC also, he'll take what he's a 48% free throw shooter. He just, as Collins knocks down the distance three. Kansas back on top, 22-20. Just under 6 minutes to play. Jefferson remains in the lineup for the Bears. Carter gets the screen, the runner, little bit short, and taken down by Markeith Morris. Numbers at the other end, and Collins couldn't handle it, and a nice job by AC to get on Collins quickly. Aldridge lost it, regained it. Collins.
He's not selling for that jump shot. He could have very easily taken that at the top of the key. But his ability to put the ball on the floor and penetrate has been huge offensively for Kansas here in the first half.
Timeout called by Baylor, which you have to be so careful of, and nobody knows it any better than Scott Drew, and that is, this is a team that streaks on you, and if you lose focus, you could look up and all of a sudden there's 8 or 10 points difference in what it was just 2 seconds ago.
Well, you can see off an offensive rebound, and Sherron Collins could have shot that ball, but his ability to get into the lane earlier in the first half, he was able to find Cole Aldridge and also Marcus and Markeith Morris down low underneath the basket. That time he takes it all the way to the rim. So versatility offensively for Sherron Collins.
Let me tell you, the interesting thing about Collins, when his head coach told everybody last year, this is his ball club. It belongs to, you know, he has earned that situation. As you look at that dish that he had for Aldridge early on in the ball game, then a little more gingerbread, and this time Marcus Morris, and then he hits the three. But my point is, he has only scored 5 points, but they have come, Hubert, in the last 60 seconds, and his ball club needed that lift because they were teetering with going back and forth as far as lead changes with this Baylor ball club.
Well, he's the one guy on Kansas' team that on a consistent basis can create a shot for himself and also for his teammates. And that's the one thing, good slip by AC. He loves doing that slip. In a pick-and-roll situation, a slip is not setting a pick, but early rolling towards the basket. AC does that 90% of the time. Better rotation from the weak side for Kansas to stop that.
He was all Big 12 freshman team last year. Here's Dunn, dishes it off and not there, and on the follow they score. That is a beautiful tip in by Udo, and they have put him in with very little time left, taking a chance. Folks, he's playing with two fouls.
There you can see in a pick and roll situation, Quincy AC slips every time in a pick and roll. He's not a pick and pop guy. He's a slip guy. You can see Coach Self, he went through that at practice yesterday and said, look, with AC in a pick and roll, you have to rotate early because he likes to slip to the basket.
Well, a reminder, men's college basketball action continues on ESPN Saturday primetime. Number 6 Duke faces off against number 16 Clemson. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV and ESPN. That's going to be 9 o'clock Eastern time. And, of course, coverage begins at 8 Eastern with College Game Day driven by State Farm.
I don't like Little John.
You don't? I didn't. Not good memories?
No. They had Dale Davis and Eldon Campbell, and I didn't play very well when I was there. So nothing against Clemson. That wasn't one of my favorite places.
You know, it's interesting. We rode out here together, and we talked about, I mean, some people have said that KU was as much as a 16-point favorite in this game. We talked about, we thought it would be terribly close, and it is just that, as we're tied, and Baylor gets another turnover right here. We've had 5 ties and 4 lead changes in the first half.
Now, that's the difference between this Baylor team as opposed to the team a couple years ago is, even though they're not scoring well, they can defend. And they're doing an excellent job defensively, not allowing Kansas to score underneath the basket in the lane.
I'll tell you what, with the size of AC and Udo, it gives them a lot more opportunities to get things done. Inside, they battle for it. So let's take a timeout. 3:43 left until halftime. Tied at 24. Effort and a noble gesture on the part of Kansas. Markeith Morris misses the first. We can look at some of the KU players on the bench, and you know, I don't know how many people read maybe that they were double digits as far as a favorite in this ball game. He misses the second one. But what you got to be careful of is, this is a Baylor team that is not void of talent by any shape of the imagination, and with the big people they've added inside plus their prowess at guard, it's you don't want to let them hang around too often.
Well, you know, they've had a lot of success on the road, not to the level of competition of Kansas, but they've won on the road at Arizona State, South Carolina, Arkansas. A couple of those teams are NCAA tournament teams, so they've gone away from home and been successful on the road. So coming in this type of atmosphere, they know what they need to do on both ends of the floor.
That foul was called on C.J. Henry. three-pointer, and Dunn got it, and he's a little shaken up. He is limping back up the floor. ...27-24, Baylor Bears. Three-pointer, not there, battling inside, taken away by AC. And they are calling, they're calling an injury timeout for Dunn. Since he went down, and I can't tell because he's a tough kid who's not going to just say anything about exactly what it is, but I think it's his ankle.
Well, on the previous play, he was out of bounds play underneath, came off of a couple of screens and hit a big three in the corner, and Kansas has to do a better job guarding him. You have to face guard him. If you allow him to catch the ball on the perimeter, he has great range. He's been terrific from three-point range here in the first half.
Tell you what, he's 4 of 4 and has got 12 points.
Look, that's too open. I mean, you can't give him that. You're going to have to switch all ball screens, face guard him, which means dribble penetration, don't help out, and find him in transition right at the half-court line. He's a guy that can change a game from three-point range. You mentioned 4 of 4 from three-point range.
Tyshawn Taylor comes into the ballgame. Has been starting. Aldridge with the turnaround jumper rattles it home. 1-point game. Baylor still on top. That's going to be a foul on Aldridge, his second. Bill Self was really upset about the no call, but what Terry Moore, the official who was right there, was saying, can't be walking because he was still juggling the basketball. Didn't have possession of it.
He was still walking. I don't care if he had possession or not. He was walking. That was a travel. They missed it. Great refereeing, but he missed that call.
Oh,
I'm on Coach Self's side that time.
Well, interesting that Terry was right there close to Bill Self when the no call came.
Rob, he was fumbling the ball all the way down Kansas' bench. At some point, you got to call traveling.
I almost screamed out fumble. It's either fumble or muff, one of the two, but that's football, isn't it?
Baylor by 2. Carter tries to make it a 3-point lead. And Dunn is down here at the other end trying to run off whatever happened to him. I still think it's his ankle. Taylor. Here's Reed. Robinson, that ball is blocked. And Udo taking a big chance with two fouls to get that block.
You know, Thomas Robinson is going to be a big-time player, outstanding freshman, but he didn't take it strong right there. Udo has two fouls. Get into his body, make him play defense.
A great point. Great point, Hubert. And as a sophomore even, or as a veteran player, that's exactly what he'll do. Shot clock is at 8. Tip. Knocked into the backcourt, and Petey Carter Reed gets it away. Collins, that ball partially blocked. Was it Carter who got a hit?
It was Anthony Jones.
Okay, Anthony Jones who got a piece of it. So Baylor comes right back. Folks, they lead by 3. We got 1:20 showing on the clock. And Bill Self has one of the most disgusted looks on his face that I have seen in a long time. Little skip pass. AC inside. Offensive foul is the call.
This is the number one a huge difference in Baylor this year. They can play defense. You see Epe Udo got his averaging close to 5 blocks a game. Blocked Thomas Robinson, freshman, down low on the paint. And then look at the effort in transition. Anthony Jones takes away a wide open three-pointer from Sharon Collins. They don't make that play last year. Playing terrific defense this year.
You know, Anthony Jones just picked up his second foul. Udo has 2, and they quickly got him to the bench with less than a minute to play. Collins with the runner, and he scores it. 1-point ball game. Baylor on top. So Anthony Jones has 2. Udo has 2, and Josh Wolmers with 3 for the Baylor Bears. Done. and they slip Jefferson inside. Boy, you're right. They do that as well as anybody that you see in this league.
Corey Jefferson has played well with the foul trouble. The freshman has come in and done a terrific job. And you see Corey Jefferson, just like Quincy Acey, a slip is acting like you're going to set the screen, but don't set the screen. You go early towards the basket, and once again, Baylor has gotten a number of points off that one play, slipping their pick and roll and getting to the basket.
Corey Jefferson, as we mentioned, a freshman. This time last year was playing for Killeen High School, which is not too far from Waco on Highway 35. Interstate 35, I guess I should say. 30-28. Baylor Bears on top by a couple. Screen out high from Markeith Morris. Nope, they got it in the hands of the man they want. 7 seconds, down to six. Collins gets the screen, going to take it all the way, reverse it. Ooh. Misses, and Markeith Morris with the foul.
Flipping towards the basket. Kansas defensively has to recognize that and do a better job rotating on the weak side.
You know, a couple of numbers to throw out at you. 6 ties, 5 lead changes. Baylor's largest lead, 3, and the largest lead for KU, 5. And KU was out-rebounded in the first half by the Baylor Bears, 17-12. Knocked out of bounds, 24 seconds on the shot clock.
Another guy offensively that I look for to be aggressive here in the second half is Xavier Henry. I mean, he's a big-time talent freshman, a guy that can really go on, get it going on the perimeter. They need him to be aggressive offensively here.
Cole Aldrich back over on the wing. Morningstar free and a little bit short on the three-pointer. And that answered my question. Lace Darius Dunn skied for the rebound. Seemed like no ill effects on the ankle.
Yeah, after one of his shot three-pointers in the corner, came down with someone's foot, twisted his ankle, was limping around latter part of the first half, but he looks like he's okay.
Okay, Morningstar, we now understand why he played 15 minutes in the first half. Not only for the poise that he brings as a turnover, that's the 6th steal on the part of Xavier Henry. Misses the shot, but that's a career high for him. But Morningstar's done a great job working against Dunn. Jones.
And one of the things with Epe Udo that he does really well, he does a nice job passing the ball out of the post. So when he catches the ball down low, Kansas is going to double team him. Anthony Jones found the open spot at the free throw line, knocked down that jump shot.
Henry going to take the long three. Nope. And you know, that shot was falling for him early in the year, and for some reason, he's gotten a little more reticent about shooting it.
Yeah, hasn't been aggressive, and I like him to take the ball to the basket like Lace Darius Dunn. When you're struggling as a shooter, one of the things you can do is put the ball on the floor, get to the free throw line, get you going.
Well, Hubert, here's the stat sheet in the first half. Morningstar just picked up that foul, his second.
Well, Lace Darius Dunn, I mean, he had 4 threes in the first half, and Baylor has to feel great. Being up by two, their two best post players, Epe Udo and also Josh Lomers, were in foul trouble, sat the bench pretty much most of the first half.
Well, the first one goes. So that now is 13 points for him. We talked about 4 of 4 from beyond the arc. He also had 2 assists in the first half, 2 rebounds, and 4 steals.
Boy, he's a complete basketball player. He's not just a shooter. He can put the ball on the floor, and this year has done a better job of distributing the basketball. So it's making an impact on both ends of the floor.
Here's Collins. Carter trying to keep up with him. Is this a 2-3, or what would you call it?
It's something. It's a zone with major size.
It's something. I love that. Anthony Jones, I think, has just been called with the goal.
You can't tell. Their front line is 6'10", 6'11", 7 feet. So I don't care what zone they're in. There's a bunch of big guys in the middle.
I tell you what, there are times with these big guys to go with these fine guards that Baylor has. They can play the zone can be the stratosphere because they really can create problems.
Well, they do switch it up. They have a 1-1-3, a 2-3, and a 1-3-1, so sometimes you can't tell the difference.
Morningstar takes the middle of the court, gets it off in the wing. Collins, yes, three. Morningstar, that's three assists for him to go with two steals.
And that's why they like him into the lineup. He's a guy that's willing to make the extra pass.
Kansas back on top by one. Carter. Udo just inside the three-point line. Aldridge, good look inside. Marcus Morris. Lomers against Aldridge, the quick double team. Udo.
Count the basket by Epe Udo. Foul call number four, Sherrod.
See, this was a mistake defensively on Kansas. They were double teaming Josh Lomers when he caught the ball outside of the paint. Lomers is a big guy that can only score when he catches the ball in the lane underneath the basket. No need to double team when he catches the ball outside of the paint. As a result, they didn't rotate, and Epe Udo was able to get the and-one situation from the weak side.
Well, Sherrod Collins with his first foul. Almost has the ball taken away by Darius Dunn. Henry drives it strong, and he took that one just the way they want him to do it, and he missed the layup.
I like the move. He was aggressive, going to the holes. He's got to be able to finish those type of plays.
Well, he's got a great quick first step for a large fella. 220 pounds, 6'6".
Doesn't look like a freshman.
Plenty of time in the shot clock. On the bench are holding up a big sign that says DT. Downtown, probably. Knocked away. Morningstar comes away with it. And now here's Collins. Marcus Morris dishes to Aldridge, and he is fouled. Let's take a timeout. Thanks very much for people who joined this one late. They may be a little surprised at the score. As Aldridge scores, that breaks the tie. They lead by one. Right now, let's take a look at our KFC grill session on what's cooking in the Big 12. Number nine. Well, all right. We'll grill that one a little bit longer. It's a little rare right now, I think. A little rare.
They didn't give you time to talk.
That's rare. Udo with the pass inside and a nice quick turnaround and the score. Darius Dunn. You don't often see him posted up, but he did right then.
Well, he did against Oklahoma State in his last game, and you can see they put Tyshawn Taylor in the game, a little undersized, and put him down on the post. Good shot, Cole Aldridge at the high post.
Cole Aldridge with the two. So Kansas goes back on top by one. Tweedy Carter. Been quiet for a while. I know you've heard the story, but if you never watched this league and ever hear, his name is actually Desmond Carter. But because he wouldn't shut up as a youngster, his grandmother put him in front of the television, and there was a, well, Tweety Bird was on there, and it came on, and the kid got quiet. And she said, I'm going to call you Tweety, and it stuck. That's about, what, 20 years ago, I think. Xavier Henry.
He's the guy that needs to get going offensively. Over the last, I say, 2 or 3 weeks, has fallen off offensively, hasn't been aggressive.
You're right.
He's got to take the same type of initiative, kind of like an Avery Bradley of Texas. The last couple weeks, he's really stepped it up offensively. They need him.
You know, the Kansas City Star had a big article on that very thing today about KU needs him as they get into conference play. And, boy, he can make life so much easier for Bill Self. 6 seconds on the shot clock. Carter misses on this one, and look at AC come away with the rebound.
And this is a great rebounding team. They have out-rebounded every opponent this year.
Hey, folks, between AC and Udo, those are really good athletes. Aldridge comes in to make the block, and the call, well, it's going to be against Cole Aldridge. And now let's get back to the grill session. Okay, turn up the heat again.
Go ahead.
Kansas State defeated Texas on Monday. Big 12 home teams. You see 121-6 this year. 15-5 in conference play. Three teams in the top 10 at Iowa State's. Are you ready for this? Steger decides he's going to go back and get on the Autobahn in Germany and leave his teammates. Coach McDermott has had his much tough lift. I mean, bless his heart.
He really has. He's an outstanding coach.
He really is a good coach. And doggone it, they have just had all kinds of disappointments. They got beat by Texas Tech tonight. And I have a feeling Steger, who was averaging about 10 points a game, was one of the reasons they lost that ball game.
He's a guy that can shoot the ball from the outside. They also lost Wesley Johnson. Everybody knows him now because he's a versatile small forward for Syracuse. But he was doing the same thing in the Big 12 for Iowa State for a couple of years.
Collins for three. Three-point lead, Jayhawks. Udo, ball fake, little soft on the shot, and it's going to be saved over in the corner by Baylor. That's big Anthony Jones who got it.
Kansas defensively has got to do a better job boxing out. Limit Baylor to one shot every possession. Huge height advantage. Anthony Jones and Xavier Henry giving away about 4 or 5 inches.
Here's Carter. They get a double on him. Shot clock still plenty of time. And an offensive foul is going to be called on the play. That's number three on Udo.
Well, you can see the versatility of F.A. Udo is power forward, being able to put the ball on the floor. But Tyshawn Taylor coming off the bench in this game, stepping up, taking the charge.
Markeith Morris. Taylor, the runner. No, very unlucky. Marcus Morris trying to save it and does not. Baylor basketball.
See, after the shot by Tyshawn Taylor, both guys going for the loose ball.
Yeah, you could see Marcus touched it last. And then very, very good sportsmanship as he helped lace Darius Dunn off one of his teammates. The bouncer inside telegraphed it. Marcus Morris. I'll tell you what, he got benched last week in Nebraska, wound up being the player of the game there. Is that the other end? Wow. Jones with a three.
This team is good. This team can play on both ends of the floor in the Big 12 this year. The beginning of the year, Texas and Kansas, but Baylor, K-State.
Henry. Markeith Morris. Jones, not there, and it's going to be called for the foul. Jones, four fouls, Lomers with three, and Udo with three as well. So goes without saying, the Bears are going to have to be very, very careful here for the last 11 minutes and 4 seconds.
Well, when you look at Kansas, they've done an excellent job of attacking those big guys. Now, it hasn't resulted in a number of free throws, but here offensively for Kansas, throw the ball down low in the post to your big guys and challenge these big guys. They are in foul trouble. You get to the free throw line and score.
will take Collins and Morris, have combined, that's Marcus, for 12 of KU's 20 points this half. This is Markieff. Nice move to the basket, and unlucky on the shot, as taken down by Lestarius Dunn. It's Marcus Morris out front working against Udo. Collins takes it away. Fouled on the way to the basket, and he'll shoot two. Tweety Carter called for the foul.
You see Sharon Collins getting into a passing lane and was able to get out in transition. This is something that Kansas hasn't been able to do on a consistent basis, get fast break points. And Sharon Collins uses his body, creates contact, and gets to the free throw line.
And actually, you can't fault Tweety Carter for the steal because it was a bad pass.
Exactly.
And Collins, who is very quick and like a shark in the water when he has a little blood there, and he just jumped on that errant pass. This now, I believe, is the largest lead of the night by Kansas, a total of six. 52-46. Largest lead in the first half was five. So let's take a timeout. Scott Drew saying, hey, we're better than that. We have to be able to move and help out our guards in a row. And right now, they got a 6-point margin with 10 minutes left to play in our ball game. Well, you look at the win streaks now. Pittsburgh lost tonight, so they're off. Missouri with 30, Siena with 30, and Dayton with 30. Carter got three.
That's that out-of-bounds play underneath. They have a 1-4 set, and then sometimes they'll throw the lob and throw it back down to Lomers underneath the basket. They also have another catch where they set a double screen, and that's how Carter was able to get to three in the corner.
Inside, Markieff Morris passes it to his brother, and he was fouled by Lomers.
That's four.
Yep. Take a look at that last out-of-bounds play that you're talking about, Hubert.
Yeah, they get great shots out of their out-of-bounds play. You can see the 1-4 set, and they throw it the ball over top. And as they throw it in to Epe Udo, they set that double screen in the corner, and they get 6 to 8 points a game out of that set. I've seen it from a number of teams, Tennessee, Ole Miss, West Virginia, run that simple play, 1-4 set, and they either get a lob underneath the basket or a three in the corner.
Well, back to a 5-point margin. Well, the Twins have really stepped it up.
Yes, they have.
Yep. I'm telling you. They have taken some of the slack up that Xavier Henry had been providing. Lomers. This is Dunn. Udo. Little ball fake. Short on the shot, and the ball tipped from one Twin to the other, from Marcus to Markieff.
Pass.
Markieff Morris not there. Well, I'll tell you what. Lestarius Dunn, for not a real big guy, gets more than his share of rebounds at 6'4", doesn't he?
He does. He hangs around that free throw line, and those long rebounds, he's usually there to pick it up.
Udo trying to avoid an offensive foul, and they're still going to call that on him. And Scott Drew, as I thought, is livid over that call. The only thing I'd have to say in Scott's favor, the defender had to move over because the big fellow was moving.
He was set right there, but Epe Udo did make a nice move to try to avoid that pick. That's the second.
Yep.
He's got two fouls tonight offensive, put the ball on the floor.
Yep. So he's going to have to come to the bench with four fouls. Jones, Udo, and Lomers all with four.
Ron, I just... the worst call in college basketball is that charge block call. If they would just put that NBA rule semicircle determining where it is a block or a charge, it would just make things so easier for the referees.
Alley-oop. Xavier Henry pulls up, short jumper, got it. Henry showing great touch right there. 8.5 minutes to play. 56-49. Largest lead of the night by the Jayhawks. Dennis has it blocked, and Markeith Morris will pick up the foul. Well, we got a couple of great basketball matchups coming up on Saturday at noon Eastern time. Number 4, Villanova takes on St. John's at the Garden. And at 2 o'clock Eastern, number 3, KU will battle some of that Hilton magic up at Iowa State. Men's college basketball presented by 5-Hour Energy on ESPN Saturday.
I know that you'll be in Ames, Iowa on Saturday.
Yes.
I am really surprised. I thought Iowa State had a chance to get to the NCAA tournament. They haven't played well in non-conference play. They have major talent. Marquez Gilstrap on the wing. Craig Brackens, a guy that gave Kansas 40 points last year, just has not played well on both ends of the floor.
Well, with the loss of the 10-point average per ball game from it yesterday, that has really left him with some hurt. As Collins on the runner, nice kiss off the glass. Now this is the biggest lead of the night by KU, 58-50.
Kansas defensively really doing a good job in a pick-and-roll situation, not allowing Tweedy Carter to split them and get the ball into the middle.
Lace-Darius Dunn rattles it in and out. And here comes Henry out on the wing to Taylor, and he has it blocked by Dennis. Well, as we've got to do, I mean, they're all the foul trouble that they've got. Can they bail themselves out?
Well, they can. I think they need to get the ball down low on the post to Epe Udo. Defensively, they've got to do a better job. Kansas has been able to get the ball into the middle, get it down low to their big guys, and be efficient on the offensive end. And also, Lace-Darius Dunn had 12 points in the first half, really hadn't gotten it going from the outside in the second.
Cole Aldridge. Ten-point lead, Jayhawks. Lace-Darius Dunn, and again, you know, the defender turned his back on him, and you simply can't do that.
Can't do that. Pick and roll situation, you have to go over the top, get the ball out of his hands. Good defense for Baylor.
Xavier misses the shot, and I think AC has just picked up the foul.
Yeah, the pick and roll situation they had. Quincy AC to slip, but Kansas did a good job picking up. But going underneath the pick and roll, that is an absolute no-no with Lace-Darius Dunn. You have to go over top. He's a guy, if the defender goes underneath, he's going to knock down that three-point shot.
Markeith Morris. I beg your pardon. This is Marcus. Well, he misses that one. Cole Aldridge with the rebound. And Sharon Collins with the three. Turnovers. How many does Baylor have second half? I know they got 20 on the game. Oh, okay. I see what you mean. They've got 6. Good deal. Good, good, good. Oh, okay. Well, I was talking to the producer. you can tell the we're trying to obtain information. And what I was trying to find out, which I told the world, 6 second-half turnovers against Baylor, so a total of 20. And none against the Jayhawks in the second half.
Well, I love Kansas defensively, particularly in the second half. They made some adjustments, done a better job on Lace Darius Dunn out on the perimeter. Really have done a great job in a pick-and-roll situation, keeping Tweety Carter out of the lane, getting deflections, allowing them to get into the open court. Defensively, Kansas has stepped it up here.
Carter, bounce pass along that baseline. AC with the jumper, yep.
That's good,
I'll tell you, Quincy Acey out of Mesquite, Texas, the all Big 12 freshman team last year. You could see why he was pretty highly sought after. Marcus Morris. Done. Nope. Jones with the long carom shot. Got the shooter's bounce and roll. And taken away by Baylor. Bill Self obviously not real happy with that sequence of events. Carter with the runner gets it to go.
Yeah, good floater. Got the ball into the lane and didn't take it all the way to the rim. Because Cole Aldridge with a block the shot. Good floater by Tweety Carter.
Log on to ESPNDallas.com. A
friendly conversation. Get things straight. Communicate.
Well, our update of the Star Watch, two of the hottest guys in the league. Dunn with 20 points. That's what he averages against Kansas career. And Marcus Morris with 18. Taylor looks up at the clock. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Very short by Henry. And here comes Lace Darius Dunn. And he'll pull up and can the short jumper.
Good play by Lace Darius Dunn. And this team still continues to compete. On that last possession, Xavier Henry, he's got a pump fake. He had Anthony Jones running out at him. He's 6'10". He's bothering his shot from the corner.
Cole Aldridge. Collins had to go very high for that one. Well, too hard off the back iron. Tyshawn Taylor tried for a little acting job there, but the officials didn't buy it, and Dunn is fouled on the way to the hoop. Marcus Morris picks up the foul. That's three on him. And Lace Darius Dunn is very slow in straightening up here. But he's going to walk to the line and prepare to shoot the two free throws.
At the line, shooting two is Lace Darius Dunn.
With Dunn, 22 points, 7 rebounds, and 4 steals, and now make it 23 points.
Well, he's been very impressive on both ends of the floor, but offensively, not just a three-point shooter. His ability to put the ball on the floor, penetrate, get to the free throw line, really good in transition, and he is a tough guard on the offensive end. But you can see Kansas, what they did. They kicked out Tyshawn Taylor and put in Brady Morningstar. They wanted to put in another shooter on the offensive end against that zone. See him land right on his back.
Yep, he has gone to the sideline so that the trainer can look him over. And I have a feeling that that's before they made the substitution for Dunn. But Morningstar had done a real good job defensively on him as well, as we had talked about.
Yeah.
About to go under 4 minutes to play. 65-63, two-point game. Kansas leading Baylor. Collins for three. Not there. Acey with the rebound.
And see, now offensively, Kansas is selling for that outside jump shot. What got them that lead was them penetrating that zone, throwing the ball into the middle, and
great
getting
point
to those big
great
guys.
Great point, Hewitt. Plenty of time and a shot clock. Bouncer, backdoor Jones. Whoa. Didn't have the key, so he just forged his way in.
Wow.
Tie ball game, 65. 3 minutes and 22 seconds and counting left in our ball game. 52-game winning streak on the line, the longest in the nation. And Morningstar was fouled. So let's take a timeout. All right, Ryan, 65 all. We're tied, and we're going to show you a number that really will get your attention as that first free throw by Morningstar goes. Kansas is really good at what they allow. 91 opponents under 50% field goals tonight. Baylor is at 56%.
And that's one of the areas with Kansas that has been up and down this year, has been able to get stops in late game situations.
2-point lead, Jayhawks. Tweedy Carter. Collins got flattened on a screen, and what a pass by Tweedy Carter over to Acey for the dunk.
He's
tied again.
Oh, he's been fantastic. When he gets the ball into the middle, he just reads the defense, doesn't predetermine, drew Kansas defenders, and found Acey. He's one of the best finishers in the Big 12 with the easy dunk.
Collins again. Well, you talk about somebody that wants the ball and loves the pressure. Number four does just that.
Both point guards. Tweedy
You're
Carter
exactly
as well.
Tweedy Carter. Nope. A little bit off. Aldridge got the rebound. Decided not to take the big outlet pass. Xavier Henry. Nope. Marcus Morris couldn't get it. Henry with the rebound, and the ball was blocked out of bounds. And they're going to say it will stay with KU. ...34 seconds on the shot clock. Morningstar. Runner, not there. Marcus Morris fouled. And let's see, is it going to be Udo? Or
all of them have four fouls.
Anthony Jones,
he's out.
Well, Anthony Jones fouls out, 9.6 rebounds. And the thing that is really impressive about what KU did in that last two sequences, for that matter, against absolutely one of the best rebounding teams, and particularly in the conference, they went up and just kept getting board after board to keep the ball in play.
Well, it's been the effort of Marcus Morris. The last three games, he's been the difference maker down low on the post. His ability to score, defend, rebound the basketball. And in this game, he's given Kansas so many second chance opportunities by keeping the ball alive. And him and his brother, Markeith, have been huge on both ends of the floor here in the second half.
Marcus gets the first one. Angel Morris looking on. mom of Marcus and Marquise. Second one. Got it as well. Took a little coaching. Four-point lead. 1:45 left in our ball game. Dunn pulls up, hits the short jumper.
Wow.
Boy, he is tough. Wow, wow. I'll tell you.
And he got fouled. Oh, this kid is terrific. Look at him. Pick and roll situation, roll, put the ball on the floor. Two dribble pull up over Marcus Marquise.
Hey, who does he remind you of, Hubert?
The microwave. You see Benny Johnson now. They got longer shorts now, but look at the same thing, being able to put the ball on the floor. And he's not a streaky shooter, but he's a streaky scorer. And you can see him. He can put the ball on the floor, go either way. And he has a knack to be able to get his shot off and knock it down.
I had to laugh at you tonight when we were looking at that video, and you said he not only does the same things, but he looks as though he studied what the microwave did as far as the way he handles the ball, the crossover dribbles and everything.
I would say that, but I don't think he was alive when the microwave was playing.
No, but there's video. There's video.
There was video back then.
It certainly would appear that he has watched the microwave play, and he comes up with the same results.
ESPN Classic.
Here are the numbers on Dunn tonight. 26 points, 5 of 7 from 3. 5 of 6 free throws, 7 rebounds, 4 steals, and 2 assists.
He's done everything. He's a complete guard, and he's also an outstanding defensive player as well. And I hope people will recognize that he's not a shooter and that he's one of the best two guards in the country.
You know, interestingly enough, Tweety Carter has got 12 points in this ball game. But Tweety, as we talked about, more interested in defense and just wanted to be a complete player. Team guy. You know, doesn't matter who's going to be the high point man, as long as it says W after the whole thing's said and done.
He's a complete point guard. I mean, he came in as a scorer. Now he can score. He can go off for 20 or 30 points, but he's a facilitator. He's done an excellent job of finding Lesdarius Dunn out on the perimeter.
71-69, 1 minute, 23 seconds left. Kansas on top by a couple. And the Jayhawks going to milk as much time as they can. Collins for three. Wow. 5 points all. 105 left. Lesdarius Dunn. No tip back. Collins comes away with it. And AC with the foul.
Well, Sharon Collins is the guy for Kansas. Late game situation, the ball is going into his hands and pulls up for the three, big three, to put him up by five. And throughout his entire career, he's not only a guy that has hit big shots, he wants the ball in his hands in late game situations.
So let's take a look at our Sonic most valuable player and a young man who is standing at the free throw line, Sharon Collins, 25 points, 9 of 16, 4 assists. And right now, with this next point, with 54.3 seconds remaining, he can make it a 6-point ball game. Collins has had 22 points plus in 4 of the last 5 ball games that KU has played.
See Baylor looking for a 3-2 possession game.
That's off the mark, an air ball, and Kansas will rebound it. Well, a reminder, men's college basketball action continues on ESPN primetime. Number 6 Duke on Saturday against ACC rival number 16 Clemson. primetime on Saturday, presented by DirecTV, 9 o'clock Eastern. And the coverage begins 8 o'clock Eastern time, College Game Day, driven by State Farm. Duke currently down by 11 to NC State. You know, the interesting thing, with 38 seconds left, this game may finish close to 10 points, and anybody who did not watch it will just see the score tomorrow and think, well, KU won again and won with ease.
No.
Not the case, not nearly the case. This Baylor team.
Get the tape.
They have battled. 8-point ball game. 35 seconds remaining. Here's Carter. Tweedy Carter, and I think it's going to be Marcus. Yeah, Marcus Morris with the foul. Boy, Collins went down hard. That's four fouls on Marcus. Well, coming up next, day four of the Australian Open, presented by Franklin Templeton Investments from Melbourne, Australia. And I think I heard him say in the last report that Leighton Hewitt would be on when coverage began. Also, Serena Williams on tap to play tonight. And the chant begins, Raksha Jayhawk. 30.2 seconds remaining. Tweedy Carter. Knocks that one down as well. Collins, Marcus Morris, and they'll just bring it out and dribble. And then Tweedy Carter picked up the foul. Tweedy with 13 points in the ball game tonight. That's four fouls on him at this juncture. Doesn't really matter. Well, I say that. 6-point game, I guess it still does matter for that matter. A couple of 3 points, and they're right there. 52 straight. Longest active in the NCAA.
Well, I mean, you can look at this Kansas team. If they come away with the win, you still look at the Jayhawks, and it's still a work in progress. They have got to get better defensively. They've been up and down throughout the year. They're starting to get consistent play out of Marcus Morris and Markeith, and they've got to get Cole Aldridge started and try to figure out their rotation. This is a team that really doesn't, Coach Self doesn't have eight guys solidified that are going to play every night, and those are the couple things that Kansas is going to have to figure out here in January if they want to be their best and have a chance to get to a Final Four and win a national championship.
Now it doesn't matter. 8-point ball game, a three-trip game with 23.7 seconds left. Carter, long three, nailed it. 17.7 seconds left. We got a Baylor foul over in the corner.
Foul number 35, Tweedy Carter, his own personal foul.
Tweedy Carter was the man called for the foul. That is four on him, 14 points for Tweedy. So the Australian Open coming up immediately following our ball game on ESPN2 from Melbourne. Day number four, down under. Markeith Morris goes to the bench. Collins got that one as well. A 30-second timeout called by Kansas with 17.7 seconds left. 81-74. And as we get close to the end, your impressions, what you've seen tonight?
Well, Baylor is going to be a major player in Big 12 play and also the NCAA tournament team. When you look at the Big 12, you know, this has to be, I don't want to get into arguing which is the best conference in college basketball, but from top to bottom, this is a conference that automatically is going to have six teams into the NCAA tournament. Yeah. They could have eight. And you talk about Kansas State, Baylor. These are teams that can go far in March, not just get into the tournament and win one or two games. So they've got four teams in this conference that have a chance to get to a Final Four. It's going to be fun to watch.
By the way, KU tonight, 51 second half points. 51 of them. This is what Kansas has coming up on Saturday. They travel to Ames. Fran Freshette and I will be up in Ames to bring that one to you on ESPN. And then followed by Missouri back here on a Monday night. And we all know about what that stands for when those two teams get together. Three-pointer, not there. Long rebound, comes back out to Carter. Another three. Nope. The foul by Dunn, missed. So now with those three shots, I'm not sure what they did to the percentage, but until that sequence, Baylor was going to break the streak of over 50%, and at 56, Marcus is going to come out to a standing ovation.
He should.
Twin brother Markeith will come back into the lineup. Morningstar comes out. Aldridge checks back in. So with the free throw, couldn't get it to go. And with the three shots they missed a moment ago, still they're going to be at 52%. And that will break the streak of over 50% by KU. 91 games ago. Collins, 0.3 seconds left. At least Darius Dunn is in pain. He has been all over this floor tonight. So has number four, Mr. Collins.